Hey everyone, my name is Kyle, and I want to take a moment to thank you for joining us online. We're going to worship together, read some scripture with one of our teaching pastors, and hear more about how our church is being a good neighbor in our community. We may be in San Diego, but if we're not in your area, we still have resources for you to check out. Make sure you subscribe to Garden Music on YouTube and our daily devotional podcast. Now let's go church together.
That surrounds me. Just one word, the darkness has to retreat. Just one touch, I feel the presence of heaven. Just one touch, my eyes were open to see. My heart can't help but believe. There's nothing that our God can't do. There's not a mountain that He can't move. Oh, praise the name that makes a way. There's nothing that our God can't do.
Yeah.
Just one word, you heal what's broken inside. Just one word, and you revive every dream. Just one touch, I feel the power of heaven. Just one touch, my greater things. There's no power like the power of Jesus. Let faith arise, let all agree. There's no power like the power of Jesus. I will believe for greater things. There's no power like the power of Jesus. Let faith arise, let all agree. There's no power like the power of Jesus. I will believe for greater things. There's no power like the power of Jesus. Let faith arise, let all agree. There's no power like His power. There's nothing that our God can't do. There's not a mountain that praise the name that makes a way. There's nothing that our God can't do. Yeah, there's nothing that our God can't do. There's not a prison wall He can't break through. Oh, praise the name that makes a way. There's nothing that our God can't do.
Awesome. You may have a seat. Well, I want to welcome you to church.
And I want to welcome you to church on a July 4th weekend. How many of you are grateful we live in a free country? You know, last week we were invited with some friends to an early fireworks show, and I was sitting there watching the fireworks with our kids, and I just reminded them of, like, guys, the fireworks are amazing and the music's amazing, but what's really amazing is that our founding fathers and men and women have fought so that we can sit here and worship Jesus, that we can grow in the knowledge of Jesus, that we can talk about Jesus, that we can have his transformational role in our life. And so on this weekend, I just want to celebrate and honor and just sit in the moment that we get to do this. This doesn't get to happen in every country in the world, amen? And so we celebrate our country, we celebrate what it took to get here, and we celebrate the fact that Jesus changes lives, amen? Speaking of changing lives, we had VBS this week. How many of you grew up going to a VBS? I did. When I was a kid, we had these, there was a famous missionary named Lottie Moon, and we would all bring our change and we'd put it in a boat, and the heaviest boat would sink into the water, and the goal was to sink your boat by the end of the week, and then we'd give all the money to missions. And I remember how fundamental and foundational VBS was for me in my life and the way that I understood who God was. And we're doing that same thing at this church. We're raising up the next generation to go first. Take a look at this video and see. I don't know if I mentioned this, but we had VBS this week. Oh, that's right. Listen, over 220 kids showed up here. When I was a kid, I grew up Southern Baptist, and there was this famous missionary named Lottie Moon. And we would do these Lottie Moon offerings, and I'm actually kind of getting emotional. Think about it. We would bring these our nickels and our dimes, and we'd fill up the boats, these little plastic boats, and we'd try to sink them with our coins. And it was the goal to see which grade could sink them fastest. And then we'd take all the coins and we'd send them to missionaries to change the world. And I remember those moments and how transformative they were in the way I understood the gospel around the world, the gospel in my life. And, you know, as a church, we committed through our Collide offering at the end of the year that we were going to raise as much money as we could. That we weren't going to be one of those churches that was weird about talking about money because nobody's living high on the hog. We're putting the money back into the kingdom. And we were going to raise as much money as we could, and we were going to put it into the next generation, and we were going to do everything we could to see their lives transform. And we did. We raised a bunch of money, and we put a bunch of money back into the kingdom, and it was at work this week. And so thank you. Thank you for being generous. Thank you for realizing the power of the kingdom of God on earth and the importance of it in our children. We did it this week together as a family. Over 50 volunteers. People took time off work. People took time out of retirement. Students came and served. That's the kind of church that we're a part of. That's a Go First church. And we just want to thank you for being a part of it. And we want to ask you to continue to. If you're not currently giving, or if you are giving, there's easy ways to do it. You can do crb.give, scan the armrest, give in the boxes. Here's our commitment to you. We will never be bashful about pulling our resources together to change our community and to change the lives of the next generation, amen? We're gonna boldly and proudly say, this is our mandate. And we're gonna celebrate the fact that God has invited us into that, amen? Would you stand with us and let's worship some more? Let's allow the transformational truth of God to bring true change in our lives this morning. Let's worship.
And in Jesus' name, we will not fail. up from the dead, let captivity captive. It is finished. Oh, you gave us the keys. Here's a thought.
Church, we believe that worship isn't just singing songs. It's also getting our hands dirty and serving in our communities. It's showing our love for God through loving our neighbors. If you want to serve beyond just a good neighbor day, head over to our website for all the ways you can make your impact. Simply sign up and you'll be put in contact with our team leads who will tell you where and when to show up. After that, the task is simple: to love our neighbors as we love ourselves. Sign up today.
Oh, the perfect Son of God, in all his innocence, here walking in the dirt with you and me. He knows what living is. He's a
There's a God who weeps. There's a God who bleeds. And oh, praise the one who would reach for me. And hallelujah to the Son of Suffering. Some imagine you are distant and removed, but you chase us down in merciful.
Thank you. Good to see you. Hey, I know we say this a lot, but I don't want to miss it again. Let's just thank Guard Music for leading us. It's just so powerful every weekend to have those anthems sung over us, just that reminder. I don't know about you, but I stand in moments all the time. I'm going, oh, this is a new challenge. Nobody's ever faced this before, which is never true. But just to hear that song, just the same God, the same things that David faced, the same thing that Moses faced, you and I face in life, and we have the same God that was faithful then. He's going to be faithful now. And isn't that powerful just to step into your Monday, your Tuesday with? Yeah. And it's just a beautiful reminder. And so we teach God's word, but we also sing God's word and God's truths. And they just do an unbelievable job leading us week in and week out, which is nice because it takes the pressure off me. I get up here, I'm like, I don't even know what I'm going to say half the time. And no, I'm kidding. But they just do a phenomenal job. Hey, happy Joris. Happy Philai Jorth is not a thing. Happy July 4th weekend. Yes. See? Guard of Music sets the standard here, and then I can't even say like a national holiday accurately. It's just embarrassing. Happy July 4th weekend. We are so thrilled and grateful to live in a country like this. Aren't you with me on that? I mean, it's awesome that we get to. Josh said this earlier, but we don't want to forget it. And I hope at some moment in your life it's settled into your bones how lucky you are to pledge allegiance to be a citizen in a country where you can gather and worship freely, that you met Jesus because of the country that you live in, or partly because of the sacrifice that men and women have made for religious freedom. And I'll never forget being in, I think it was like second grade, and I went to Washington, D.C. for the first time. And it was July 4th weekend, and there was a presidential parade, and President Reagan came rolling down, and I was in, you know, like 1,000 miles away. But I remember looking at my dad. It was like 115 degrees, and I looked at my dad and said, I'm going to be president of the United States one day. My dad didn't respond when I told him that, but I hope all of you have had that moment in your childhood at some point where it's settled into your bones, and this weekend you get a moment to remember what a fantastic privilege that is. We're in the middle of a series on David, the life of David. David is a father. David is a king. And what I want to look specifically at today is David, at an early age, someone came to him and said, you have a lot of potential. And David's a guy who fulfills that potential. He ends up on the Mount Rushmore for Israel. He's a guy that kings, rulers, no matter where you are in the world today, everybody knows about David. And we've just been looking at some of the granular details of his story. But how does he fulfill his potential? I don't know about you, but when I was a kid specifically, I hated the you have a lot of potential speech. Anyone remember that speech? Anyone get that a lot? Typically for me, that speech came in a principal's office. And it was followed by a lot of information that didn't sound like I had a lot of potential. And people would say that to you. And eventually, you ever notice that you get to some age where people stop saying that to you, and it's either you reached it or they just gave up. They're like, well, I guess not. And as much as I hated it, I say it to my kids. And it's a beautiful thing to say. It really is. You have a lot of potential. And what you mean is I can see something in you that there's a destiny there. There's a purpose there. And there's so much capacity in you if you can tap into the passion to become that kind of individual. And I say that to my kids a lot. I say there's potential for something great here. I want to speak that over my kids' lives. I imagine you want to speak that over the next generation of our church, your sons and daughters. There's potential. You want to see that. You don't want to, see your kid do something. You're disappointed. You go, well, I never had any thought you had any potential. Anyway, you want to live seeing the potential in others. As Christ followers, I mean, this is at the heart of the gospel. The moment you step into a relationship with Jesus, now the potential is limitless of who you can become in Christ. This seed has been planted in you. It's growing. It's producing. So there's potential. And I want to look specifically today at how David fulfills his potential and how you and I typically evaluate potential, and it's very different than how God evaluates potential. It's very different than how God determines if you reach your potential. It's very different than how we often think about what it means to be a person who can reach their potential. And David embodies the real core, the real engine of being an individual who can reach his potential. If you have a Bible, I would encourage you to turn it a chapter before the David and Goliath story. That's been the centerpiece of the last 3 weeks. But I want to look at 1 Samuel 16, David, Goliath 17. We'll get there in a moment. 1 Samuel chapter 16, this is the moment when a prophet comes to David and gives him the potential speech and says, you're the guy. How it worked in Israel was they had prophets and kings, and the prophet was always the guy who determined who the king was. And prophets were scary people in the Old Testament because when they spoke, you didn't know what God had said. It might be a judgment, might be game over, might mean you were going into captivity for 70 years. You didn't know. People didn't really like prophets. If you read Jeremiah, he gets put in a sewer underneath the city for a while. They're just tired of hearing from him. It didn't really work out. God still got his way. But prophets were, they were viewed with some skepticism. Samuel was a prophet at this time. The nation of Israel had begged God for a king over and over again. Finally, God gives them Saul. Saul's a wicked king. God goes to Samuel and says, we need a new king. And Samuel's like, agree, any ideas? He said, yeah, I'm going to show you. You go to the house of a man named Jesse. Jesse has a bunch of sons, the youngest of which is David. And this is how the prophet Samuel determines, well, it's David who has all the potential. So if you have a Bible, 1 Samuel chapter 16, we'll start in verse 4. You ready to go? You ready to go? I like your style. Okay, Samuel did what the Lord said. When he arrived at Bethlehem, what happened in Bethlehem? What else? Yes, the answer in church is always Jesus. Okay, there you go. When he, I promise the next series I will not use that joke again. When he arrived at Bethlehem, the elders of the town trembled when they met him. Why? Because they're terrified. What in the world is this prophet going to do? So they asked the prophet Samuel, do you come in peace? Because half the time when a prophet shows up around here, it's holy fire. He says, yes, I come in peace. I have come to sacrifice to the Lord. Consecrate yourselves and come to the sacrifice with me. Then he consecrated Jesse, this is the father, and his sons, and he invited them to the sacrifice. So he's trying to size up the boys of Jesse to determine which one of these has the potential. Who does the Lord see the potential in to be the king? And he says, bring your sons here and we're going to figure this out. So when they arrived, all the sons, it says Samuel saw Eliab. So he probably the oldest and thought, surely the Lord's anointed stands here before the Lord. And so Samuel sees Eliab and thinks, strapping, handsome, Gaston-like, this must be the guy. And God says to Samuel, not so fast. The Lord said to Samuel, do not consider his appearance or his height. Don't look at his appearance or his height to determine his potential. For I have rejected him, which I love. Eliab's got to be like, well, what did I do? The Lord does not look at the things that people look at. So how God determines potential is not how you and I determine potential. People look at the outward appearance, but the Lord looks at the, what's the word? The heart. But the Lord looks at the heart. And later, David is called a man after God's own heart. There's something about his heart. When you and I are trying to, Malcolm Gladwell calls this thin slicing, where we're trying to evaluate people, and we all do this. We judge people, we make decisions about people based on appearance. We do this in our lines of work. Well, you know, look at what he's wearing. He must be a finance guy. Look at how she's dressed, real estate. And I'm not judging anybody on that. It was not a point, in case you're wondering, like, really me? We do this in our life. Well, they must be successful. Well, look at, you know, their shoes. They must not be so. Look at that. And on the other side of that, we try to be picked as a person who has potential, as a friend, as a candidate for a job. And we know that if you can appear a certain way, you'll potentially be viewed as a person that gets the outcome that you want. And so we focus a lot, more than any other nation that has ever existed. We focus on appearance. We focus on the look of something. You've probably been, you know, at some point somebody's said something. You're like, well, you don't look like a, I get this a lot, you don't look like a pastor. To which I always, you know, I don't know what a pastor is supposed to look like. But you know those moments. We thin slice one another. We make decisions quickly based off of people's appearance. And so we try to pad our appearance. We try to appear a certain way based on the outcomes in this life that we want. The other thing that we evaluate one another, we thin slice one another over, is talent. Well, what's your talent level? What's their skill set? What are they good at? That determines potential. If they seem to be good at this, if they get in this opportunity, they'll probably succeed. Or based on this skill set, talent level, they're going to fail. That's how we evaluate. That's how we determine potential. And consequently, that's what we raise our sons and daughters to have. We want to have the right education, the right talent, have the right appearance, focus on, you know, tuck that shirt tail in, you know, have sort of this presentation to the world. That's what really matters about you. The problem with talent and appearance is they're kind of like a magic trick. How does a magic trick work? A magic trick, let me get you to focus on this so I can I can divert your attention away from this. Let me fool you here by doing this so that I can get away with doing this. How many of you have ever been pickpocketed before? Anybody? What a nice, cozy life you all live. you're like, it's Rancho Bernardo, for crying out loud. What does a pickpocketer do? It focuses your attention on grabbing your arm or something that doesn't appear to be of consequence, just lightly brush into you, so that they can do something of consequence. Take your wallet, take your purse. That's a bit like how talent and appearance work. It diverts your attention away from the thing that really matters, that God looks at the heart. How many of us, you've ever been relationally pickpocketed before? How many of us, you've ever been fooled into something? Well, this is not what I thought. And you couldn't determine the heart of somebody, and it caused you a lot of pain and a lot of grief. God says what actually determines the potential is the heart. It's the core. My kids... 24/7 in our house, they're always watching sports, but this year I think they took it to a new level. They weren't just watching sports, they were watching the NBA draft. Anyone ever watch a draft before? You shouldn't. It's very boring. It's just guys in suits standing at a microphone. But this year, my boys wanted to watch, it was a couple weeks ago, the NBA draft. And drafts are fascinating, they really are. Because they're evaluating these 19, 20-year-olds all based on their talent and appearance, and they're trying to determine their potential. And you've got guys who've never played the sport before sitting behind a desk going, well, I don't know, Bob. I think, you know, he's, you know, 6'8" and he seems to be pretty fast. And rumor has it that his mom drives a Nissan, so it comes from a good practical family. I don't know. And they're just throwing all the cobbling together some story to determine the potential of the athlete. And this year in the NBA draft, there was a guy that was the number one draft pick, and he had been picked to be the number one draft pick since I think he was about 4 years old. Anybody know his name? Victor? Yeah, you didn't even attempt that last name. Yeah, that was smart. Wimbignana. He's from anybody? He's from France. There you go. That's easier to say. Victor Wimbignana. Probably already has like 9 shoe deals. I don't know. But it's all based on potential. And what are they looking at with Wimbignana? They're looking at his appearance, which it kind of helps that he's 7'4". You didn't know that? You didn't know Wimbignana? They're looking at his appearance. They're looking at his talent. But neither of those things really will determine his success. What ultimately determines his success? Heart, character. And God says to Samuel, listen, what I need in a king, what will determine the potential, what will determine the purpose, what will determine the passion, who this individual becomes, is not what you look at, it's heart. Now the question is, how do you determine that? So God says, all right, I want you to go back to the drawing board, Samuel. Let's see if we can find somebody who actually measures up. It says, the Lord said to Samuel, do not consider him. And then in verse 8, it says, we got to find somebody else. Jesse called Abinadab, another one of the sons, and he had him pass in front of Samuel. Samuel said, the Lord has not chosen this one either. It's like the worst dodgeball lineup ever, just over and over again. Not picked. Jesse then had Shema pass by, but Samuel said, nor has the Lord chosen this one. It's a bit of a Simon Cowell moment here for Samuel over and over. Jesse had 7 of his sons pass before Samuel. But Samuel said to him, the Lord has chosen none of these. So he asked Jesse, are these all the sons you have? Which I just love. Like, there's 7. What do you want? And he says, well, there's the one who I didn't even think had the potential to be in the potential. He's like, well, where's the lowest potential guy at? And he says, well, he's tending sheep. He's the youngest. And Samuel said, well, send for him. We will not sit down until he arrives. And so you know the story. This is just how God works in general. The person who has the talent and the appearance, God's never interested in. In the Old Testament, there's a practice that's called primogentry. And how the practice of primogentry works, it essentially says the oldest son gets the birthright. The oldest son gets all the blessing and the favor. They're the one that gets everything. And then they answer that phone call. But the oldest son gets everything. And if you notice in the Old Testament, God, he pushes back on primogenitory. It's never the oldest. For God, it's not Cain, it's Abel. It's not Jacob, it's Esau. It's not Eliab. It's not the one who should, it's David. It's never the striking, beautiful woman. It's the barren woman who gets the blessing over and over again in the scriptures. It's the place where you go, really, God? That's where, and he says, look, I evaluate potential, not on talent or appearance. I evaluate it based on heart. David has the potential. Why? Because I see to what you do not. So the question is, how for yourself do you develop heart? How for your kids do you develop heart? How do you become the kind of person? What is it that David's doing? Well, the next passage says, well, he's out in the field with the sheep. The next passage, David is in front of Goliath. So a short period of time, here he is in front of Goliath. And a battle's taken place. We looked at this over the last couple of weeks. Contest of champions has to happen. The king, Saul, is standing on the sideline 40 days, 40 nights. No one wants to go face the giant. And finally, a shepherd boy from Bethlehem, his dad, who I guess still didn't think he had any potential, sends him to the battle, but merely for the purpose of bringing lunch to his brothers who have the talent and the appearance of warriors. And so David shows up with some lunches and sees what's going on in the moment. And I love this. He reads the moment and says, oh, this is something about Samuel coming to me and anointing me king. And something about my destiny is now in this moment. And he says, I'm the guy. And David said to Saul, because they pushed back on him. They're like, I don't think so. He says, your servant, so how do you qualify? What's on your LinkedIn profile for this gig? And he says, your servant has been keeping his father's sheep. Okay? When a lion or a bear, and the secret is in this. He says, when a lion or a bear came and carried off a sheep from the flock, I went after it, struck it, and rescued the sheep from its mouth. This is a guy who takes shepherding very serious. When it turned on me, I seized it by its hair, struck it, and killed it. Don't know if you ever encountered a lion or a bear before. Not my immediate reaction. And so David, essentially, I love this about David. He's remembering his past. So he shows up to the battle, and Saul and all the generals of Israel look at him and go, if you lose this battle against Goliath, it's not just you who loses, it's all of us who lose. Why do you think you can do this? And no one else had had the courage to stand up, so they're curious. Why do you think you're the guy? You're going to risk your own life. And they're looking at him going, you don't have the talent to do it. You certainly don't have the appearance to do it. Why do you think you could do it? And I love this about David. He remembers his past. And he goes back to the lions and the bears. And he essentially says, listen, I was faithful with the small things. I had heart. I had character. In moments that seemed to have no significance, I determined that they were significant. When a normal average shepherd would have just let the bear or the lion run off with the sheep, I risked my life because I saw in the small task, it was actually a holy task. And I was faithful in the small. And because I was faithful in the small, I can stand in the valley today. And because I killed the lion and the bear, something about that, it was stepping stones to this moment. And he remembers his past. I'm sure David, when he was in the shepherd's field and he was slaying lions and bears, wasn't going, oh man, they're going to paint this on the Sistine Chapel one day, me killing a lion. I'm sure he was thinking, surely I'm going to get a bust made of me and they're going to put me in Florence one day, because this is so magnificent that I killed a lion or a bear. No, it seemed insignificant. But it was the very thing. This is what determines heart. This is far more valuable than talent or appearance. It's being faithful with the small things when nobody's watching, when it doesn't seem to matter. It's in those moments when you don't compromise on your character, when you treat the small task as if it's a holy task and a holy opportunity. It's when you're faithful with the small things over and over again, that ultimately becomes the thing that determines your heart and your character. And it also determines the size of the opportunity that God's going to place in front of you at another point in your life. And so he sees that. This lion bear, it was connected to this. And this is true for all of us. How you do one thing in your life, you ever notice this? It's how you do everything in your life. I wish that wasn't true, but it is. You know, if you keep a messy desk at work, there's a 100% chance I'm going to get into your car and the back seat of it is going to look like you could find Jimmy Hoffa back there somewhere. It's just, how you do one thing is how you do everything. If you treat this individual like they're insignificant, you probably treat everybody like they're insignificant. You ever have somebody come to you and start talking about somebody else like, you know, I don't really like so-and-so, and they're gossiping about this person? What do you think they're doing when you're not? They're gossiping because how you do one thing, it's how you do everything. And so you start treating the small moments of your life, the things that seem insignificant, as if they actually have weight and significance. That's what determines character. That's heart. And David looks at Saul and say, I may not have the army. I may not have the power. I may not have the talent. I may not have the appearance, but I have what you don't. I have heart. I've been faithful in the small. And that determines my heart, my character, that I can be faithful in the big moments. Think about your own story today. Think about those moments of your life where you've stood in valleys and you've stood in seasons where you're going, why in the world am I here? This seems so insignificant. This makes me feel insignificant. Maybe there's seasons you just felt like a failure. Like this is just painful. This is just, maybe it's punishment. I don't know. But it just feels like there's no rhyme or reason. This is just random. It was that 6 months, that random job. It was that 2 years in that relationship that it all just fell apart. It was that season where you just banged your head against the wall going, I don't get this. I don't get this. I don't get this. But isn't it true when you step back in the grand scheme of things, God does not waste any pain. Nothing is random in the economy of God. And they were all just setbacks or lions and bears to prepare you for the moment you were going to face Goliath. And if you were faithful in those moments that seemed insignificant, God has a way of bringing the significant to you and saying, okay, now because I could entrust you with this, I can entrust you with this. And it's your job and mine to connect the dots to say, okay, my job in every moment, every season is to show up to every small task like it's a holy task. That's what determines whether or not you fulfill your potential. When they were building the very first temple in Israel, you have people grumbling, going, you know, when is this ever going to get done? How long is this going to take? And it took a long time. And through the prophet Zechariah, God said this, do not, verse 10 of chapter 4, do not despise these small beginnings. Anyone here, you just admit you hate small beginnings? You hate those moments where it feels like we're not getting anywhere. This is just a meeting. It's just I hate practice. Let's play the game. Let's get to the big thing. God says, no, I love small beginnings. For the Lord rejoices to see the work begin. Zerubbabel, he says, the plumb line is in Zerubbabel's hand. And that's the moment when God's looking at a guy with a measuring stick in his hand and figuring out the dimensions. God's going, I'm celebrating in that moment. God's not only in the moment. God's not only celebrating the moment when it's all finished and it's done. God's going, no, every step of the way, every lion, every bear. It's not just the moment Goliath falls that God's going, all right. But God's going every step of the way. Every small piece of the story, which means you and I have to show up, and this is character, this is heart, to every moment going, every small task is a holy task. Every small thing, how I do one thing is how I do everything. Every opportunity is an opportunity from God. And if I'm faithful in this over and over again, the lions and the bears, it's what leads me. Listen, right now, you don't believe this about something you're facing that feels perhaps insignificant, but God is preparing you for your finest hour. And you have to step into that every moment going, there's something at stake here. So much hangs in the balance. Jesus said it this way in Luke chapter 16, verse 10. He says, whoever can be trusted with very, what's the word? Little, can also be entrusted with much. And whoever is dishonest and with very little will also be dishonest with much. That's how God determines, are you trustworthy? I do this with my kids. They'll come home and they've made $10 at the, they'll sell things, especially in the summer, they'll sell things in the driveway. It might be rocks, and between you and I, it's a ripoff. But they'll come and I get $10. And I'm like, who are our neighbors, man? Honey, we need smarter neighbors. They're paying $8 for a rock. But they'll come home and or they'll walk in the house and they've got their $10. I'll say, okay, here's how this is going to work. One of these $10 is God's dollar. And they're like, I'd like to clarify that, Dad. All 10 of those dollars are my dollars. And I'm like, well, no, but why? Why have to do this with my $10? Because it's God's money. They're like, didn't see God sitting out there selling rocks today. Pretty sure it was me. No, this is God's money. Because one day your $1 is $1,000. One day your $1,000 is $100,000. And if you're faithful with the little, if you get this now, this is just lions and bears, but one day it's going to be a Goliath son. And you apply that to every area of your life in the small things. And that's true at any age, any stage. Being the person who shows up to the meeting with a poise and a confidence and a sense there's something holy at stake here. I wonder how God's going to use me in this. You step into every conversation. Every small task is a holy task here. And I don't want to miss what God's doing. All those lions and bears, they accumulate. Rabbi David Wolpe, talking about Israel's history, used a quote one time that I absolutely love. And if you know anything about the nation of Israel and everything they've been through, you get this at a certain level. It's always in peril. It's always at risk. And he said this: there are troubling signs to be sure, yet through our past runs a golden thread of providence. I love that line. A golden thread of providence that has not been snapped by catastrophe and mid-year indifference. And so that's David. He's going, there's a golden thread of providence that I can see from that moment to that moment, and I'm trusting God that that golden thread of providence is not going to get snapped in front of Goliath. And that you'd step into moments with that same confidence. That's character. That's what determines potential. And so David says it again to Saul. He says, your servant has killed both the lion and the bear. This uncircumcised Philistine will be like one of them because he has defied the armies of the living God. The Lord who rescued me from the paw of the lion and the paw of the bear will rescue me from the hand of this Philistine. And so David sees the lion, sees the bear, because he knows it's going to lead him to seize his divine moment when it comes. And I don't know about you, but I often pray, just God, keep all the lions and bears away from me. Anyone else? Any threat, God? Most of my prayers are prayers of prevention. Anyone else? Just keep it away. And then when it comes, I'm going, don't know what you're doing, God. Don't know what you're up to. And we start looking at the things that come in our life and we go, well, it's just pain. I don't know why God's allowed this pain. And there is a lot of truth in that question. Why does God allow this pain? We look at other moments in our life, depending on how fatalistic we are, go, I don't know why God's allowed this punishment. I feel like I'm being punished. Anyone else? Something bad happens to you. You're like, this is about that slumber party in eighth grade. And I know God's just getting me back. And oh my goodness. And you're just constantly looking at it, well, this is pain or this is punishment. Listen, what you and I view as pain and punishment, God views as preparation. And he's raising you up so that when the Goliath comes, you have the strength to face it and seize your divine moment. But he's got to take you through some lions and bears to get there. And so in the prayers of prevention, yes, okay, God, keep it away. But at the same time, have a prayer of preparation. God, what are you preparing me for? Because I know you're not going to waste this. And the same is true in terms of raising our kids. We want to prevent everything, any obstacle. We want to keep all the lions and bears away from our kids. And that's true in a literal sense, by the way. You should do that. But anytime there's risk, just get it away, just get it away, just get it away. And then we throw them into the real world and go, well, I wonder why they're not prepared. God doesn't parent you that way. He exposes you to risk. And the same is true. One of my favorite quotes from one of my favorite parenting books, author named Wendy Mogul wrote a book called The Blessing of a Skinned Knee. I bought the book based on the title. We had a lot of those in our house at that time. And she said this, real protection means teaching children to manage risks on their own, not shielding them from every hazard. And that's true as a child of God. He doesn't shield you from every hazard. He's protecting you by not preventing the pain. He's actually preparing you for a life where you've reached your potential and the Goliaths that are going to come. And we forget that. That's why we have church every week, by the way, because we forget that so easily, that God's doing something in all these moments and there's a golden thread of providence. And David forgets that. And it says later in David's life, I don't have time to tell the whole story, but the Ark of the Covenant has been lost. It's been stolen and Israel wants it back. David wants it back. The Ark of the Covenant was not invented by Indiana Jones, by the way. It's in the Old Testament. It was a sign of the presence of God and it's gone. And David's going, we got to get it back. But if I go get it back, I could die. And now there's a prophet named Nathan who comes to David, who's forgotten about the lions, the bears, and Goliath. And he says, let me remind you, David. Now then, tell my servant David, this is God. This is what the Lord Almighty says. I took you from the pasture, from tending the flock, and appointed you ruler over all my people Israel. I have been with you wherever you have gone. I have cut off all your enemies from you. David, did you forget? I took you from a shepherd in a field. I took you from the lions, the bears, when you thought you were going to die, when you thought it was all going to blow up, you thought it was all going to go wrong over and over again. Do you think I'm going to fail you now? I don't know where that lands on you today, but there's some area of life where you're going, what if this is the one time God's going to let me down? He's going, are you kidding me? What about right now as a mom, as a dad? What's the Goliath you're facing? What's the obstacle you're facing? It could be a son or a daughter. You're looking at their story, and they're in a lion-bear moment, and you're going, I don't know how they're going to get out of this. I don't know if they're going to ever grow up out of this. I don't know. She's 38, for crying out loud. I don't know if she's ever going to, you know, get it. And God says, just stand by. Trust a golden thread of providence in their story. Right now in your business, your knees are knocking. You're going, I am in the valley. There is a Goliath in front of me. I do not know what to do. Would you just take a moment, instead of being so anxious about your future, look back to your past and remember the lions and the bears? You're far more prepared than you think you are to stand in and stand up to the challenge. And God's used all this, and there's a golden thread of providence that leads to this moment. And you can think back over and over again on the faithfulness of the Lord and your faithfulness to be faithful to God, even when you didn't know if there was going to be a sign of his faithfulness back over and over again. And there's a golden thread of providence that runs through your story. As you raise your sons and daughters, what is it you're praying for today? Prevent, 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 prevent. The heart of a go-first person is someone who says, prepare, prepare, prepare. God, you did not prevent it, but I wonder what you're preparing me for, because you are not a God who just puts pain or punishment in my path. You're a God who's preparing me all the time. And I want to step into that as a leader, as a mom, as a dad. That's David. And that's where he gets his courage from and his hope to be the person who has a heart after the Lord. Let's pray together. God, I thank you. You're always preparing us. You're always doing something. And it doesn't feel like it. We look at life in a little 3x5 frame and we're staring at it going, I don't get it. But you're looking at a golden thread of providence. Would you allow us to see the connection between the lions and the bears in our story and where we are? Would you cause us just to be faithful with the small tasks, the holy tasks, God. That's character, that's heart, that's what determines our destiny. And I pray over every single man, over every single woman in this room, God, raise us up to be faithful in the moment to you, to be the kind of person who slays the Goliath. And we don't do that alone, God. We do that because someone else came up out of Bethlehem, Jesus Christ, and he stands with us. He stands ahead of us. And we know you go ahead of us, God, into the valley that we're in. And so, God, we thank you that we do not go alone and that you're always preparing us for something more beautiful. And it's in Jesus' name that we pray, and all God's children said, amen. Grace and peace.
Thanks for coming to church with us today. We want you to know that we're here for you. If you want to connect with a pastor or a counselor, please call the church at the number below. And don't forget to engage with our daily devotionals and worship throughout the week with Garden Music, wherever you like to stream. We'll see you next time.